We start in the NBA, though, with Russell Westbrook. OKC Thunder fans devastated earlier this NBA offseason when Kevin Durant chose not to re-sign with the team and go to the Warriors, but now they have something to smile about. League sources told ESPN Westbrook has agreed in principle to a deal with the Thunder for 3 years worth $85.7 million. Westbrook will make an extra $8.7 million this upcoming season. He has a player option for the third season. Stephen A., how bad does this make KD look?
Well, it depends on how you look at it. If Kevin Durant had come out and said that, you know what, I just don't want to be in Oklahoma City anymore. I want to be in some place, like my man Chris Rock says, where you can order sushi at 4 in the morning as opposed to Oklahoma City, then he doesn't look bad. But if you're talking about being in a situation and not departing from a winning situation and not being perceived as jumping on a bandwagon, I think Kevin Durant looks very bad, because by Russell Westbrook signing this deal, clearly it's not a long-term deal. He's only really committing for one additional year. He's getting himself about a $9 million raise. It was a good business decision on his part, no doubt, but it also showed a willingness to play and to stay in OKC, not escape to Los Angeles or anywhere else we were speculating that he might want to go. And in the end, what it comes down to is this: Kevin Durant didn't believe that winning with Russell Westbrook was a possibility. You can slice it any way you want to. In the end, if you're chasing a championship, Kevin Durant chose Steph Curry over Russell Westbrook. You can slice it any way you want. He can try to couch it. He can try to massage it. He can try to sit there and wiggle his way around it. Who gives a damn? That's what this comes down to, because Russell Westbrook making the claim and the proclamation that indeed he's willing to stay in OKC with Steven Adams and Victor Oladipo there with him, carrying this team or whatever. You can sit there and speculate that he wants to be the man, and obviously that is, there's some truth to that, because he likes shooting the basketball. There's no doubt about that. He's a career 21 point per game scorer. We know how electrifyingly athletic he is, the most athletic point guard in the history of the NBA, if that's what you really want to call him, a point guard. But in the end, Kevin Durant can slice it any way he wants to. He preferred the thought of playing with Steph Curry more so than playing with Russell Westbrook. That's what this move comes down to, because Russell Westbrook saying that he's not willing to leave in all likelihood is something that he made clear to Kevin Durant, and Kevin Durant chose to part ways anyway, Mike.
If your thesis is that this makes Durant look bad, then Stephen A., Mr. Basketball, I respectfully disagree. Look, in the moment, Westbrook wins the headline. Westbrook wins the hearts of the old school guys who consider it, you know, the tough guy, old school way to, damn it, you stay where you are and you try to make best, we know, with what you got. He'll win the headline today, and he'll make Durant look bad today. But that's okay, because there'll be more headlines tomorrow, and the headlines will read eventually. Kevin Durant made it to X Finals, and that X going to be more than one on that squad. And one Y Finals, and that Y is probably going to be more than one on that squad, too. So history will record. And then years from now, there'll be documentaries about how, well, Westbrook never won a title, but you have to understand, he was the guy who stayed there. And what were Westbrook's options? And Westbrook is my favorite player in the NBA. That guy, like, has rabies when he plays. That guy is unbridled aggression. There's no one I like to watch more than Russell Westbrook. But what were his options? He's not a free agent, so any team that traded for him would have to gut their team, and he wouldn't be going to a very talented team. And then even look at the teams who could really use him to put him over the top. A lot of them have point guards. What was he supposed to do? So what did he do? He optimized his money by getting paid now, by having opt-outs when he gets 10 years in the league, so he gets a new max deal at new max money. He did the smart thing. I don't think it makes Durant look bad at all.
Well, he did the smart thing from a business perspective. And it's not a matter of Durant looking bad because he decided to leave OKC. I've been on the record saying I have no problem with Kevin Durant deciding to leave OKC. I had a problem with him picking to go to the team that actually knocked him off and had actually beat him. But you also have to remember that Kevin Durant is after championships. Kevin Durant wants a ring. Kevin Durant was on a championship contender and decided to go to the very team that beat him, who happens to have the reigning two-time league MVP, who plays the same position as Russell Westbrook. So essentially, what you're saying, after coming to Russell Westbrook's defense in press conferences where Mark Cuban talked about him and other places where other media pundits and beyond have talked about Russell Westbrook, the number one protector, the number one defender of Russell Westbrook was Kevin Durant. Yet when it was time and you had an opportunity to make a decision, you chose somebody over Russell Westbrook in order to go and play with them. Now, I'm not saying that makes Kevin Durant look bad, but I'll tell you what, it does make him look a bit disingenuous, considering how so quickly he was willing to come to the defense of Russell Westbrook, only to jump and, you know, just skip out of town the second he had an opportunity to. In the end, again, it doesn't make Kevin Durant look bad. I don't mean to imply that. What I'm trying to say is, let's be real. Let's be real. In the end, it comes down to one reality and one reality. You did not believe you could win a championship with Russell Westbrook.
Well,
that's what you're saying. Now, by the way, just to get to your point, because you're quick to sit up there and say, Stephen A., is the insider talking? Did you hear this from somebody? Or is this what you believe? Let me clarify. When it comes to this particular issue, yes, I have people close to Kevin Durant, regardless of what he thinks. I am telling you what they said. He cannot win. Their words were, he cannot win a championship with Russell Westbrook, Stephen A., and you damn well know it. And I said, did Kevin Durant say that? And they said, no comment. Now that's the insider. What I deduce from that is, clearly that's what you believe. And clearly you were convinced to believe that, and you might not have needed to be convinced to believe that, but it's clear you don't feel that Russell Westbrook was going to facilitate you capturing a championship. So all of this bloviating in his defense all of these years seems a bit disingenuous at this point.
What do you want him to do when that's his teammate? That's his partner in crime. He's got to pump him up. Now, you don't want to turn Russell Westbrook.
Was wrong.
You don't want to turn Russell Westbrook into something that he's not. You can only tamper with his kind of aggression so much. But I can't hold it against Kevin Durant that he spoke out and spoke up for what Russell Westbrook while they were teammates, but that when it came down to him making a decision for his career, Stephen A., he's looking at 30 in the not-too-distant future, and he's looking at Westbrook, who's more talented than Steph Curry or anyone on the Warriors, more talented, but he's looking at the Warriors and saying, why does this have to be so hard in terms of the way we play? Why does it have to be a question who gets the last shot? Why do we have to be playing in isolation so much? I want to play the right way with those guys. You know who gets the last shot? The open man. I don't want to have to worry with all
of things. You know what? You should be ashamed of yourself. I can't believe you just uttered those words out of your mouth. And I understand you cover the sport of boxing, and in the end, that's an individual sport because you're in that boxing ring all by yourself. I do get that point. I do get that reality. But let's also not act like you don't know. When you're talking about elite athletes, how you duck and run for cover with the team that beat you. When they were up 3-1, Kevin Durant had everything to do with them losing that 3-1 lead. It wasn't just Russell Westbrook. Even though Russell Westbrook and him combined to turn over the ball 6 of their last 8 possessions, you know why I didn't blame Russell Westbrook for that? Because the mistakes that Russell Westbrook made, he always made. It was Kevin Durant that looked a bit different. It was him going down taking shots 1-on-2. It was him forcing the issue. It was him looking like the antithesis of what we knew Kevin Durant to be. And again, he's not wrong. I'm not trying to come across as he's wrong, nor am I trying to come across as him being somebody that should have dimed out his players or called out his teammate. What I'm saying is, Max, there does come a point in time where you can shut the hell up. You can sit up there and go like this. Well, you know what? I'm not going to dog my teammate, but what I'm not going to do is come to his defense every chance I get and dog out anybody who has something accurate to say about him, when in the end, your actions are indicative of exactly what pundits were saying about him. You chose the Golden State Warriors over Oklahoma City because you chose Steph Curry over Russell Westbrook because you believe believe you got a better shot at winning a title with him than with your man that was by your side for the last seven
and
8 years.
Not just,
that's the reality.
Not just Steph.
That's the reality.
And Klay Thompson. And Draymond Green.
Sure.
And Steve Kerr. And Andre Iguodala. They have a bunch of unselfish players. A lot of them can shoot the lights out, too, by the way, which is not the case in OKC. Who's going to shoot the ball in OKC from a
right.
distance at this point?
Right.
But I want to get back to what you said about how they both choked, Westbrook and Durant, down the stretch.
I don't think Russell Westbrook
choked. Well, Westbrook didn't play well down the stretch.
But he usually does it at times.
Right. Oh.
Kevin Durant, my definition of choking is when
you turn into something else. So,
when times
so
get
why
tight.
Do you let Westbrook off the hook for the fact that he frequently does that?
Because that's always been his game, because he's aggressive and he's a rat.
And that's why. What, look at Miami with LeBron and Wade. Now, it was a new team. New dynamic, etc., though there was a new coach in OKC. Look at that dynamic. Part of the problem early is they came into conflict. Whose team is it? Who's going to get the ball, etc., until Wade deferred because LeBron's superior talent just took over. Westbrook had closed the gap with Durant. It was not clear whose team it was. It was not clear who was alpha when they were on the floor. It was disrupting chemistry. And Durant tried to extricate himself from that and go to a team, by the way, which when he was on OKC, they were more talented than Golden State. I can't knock him for that.
Go ahead,
no, once you respond, I have another question on Westbrook. I want to get you guys to.
You know, Max Kellerman.
What a less talented team.
You know, Max Kellerman, I got to confess. You're annoying me this morning already. I must confess this. I'm going to tell you why.
I'm doing something right.
I love when Stephen A starts getting annoyed.
I'm going to tell you why you annoy me. Because it's like you talk about Kevin Durant like he's Stephen Adams or Victor Oladipo or somebody. He's Kevin Durant. He was up 3-1. You're one of the top three players in the world. No matter how great Russell Westbrook is, he ain't better than Kevin Durant. So when you talk about what Kevin Durant is joining, well, damn. I mean, you're the superstar, and you were up 3-1. You were supposed to close the door even more so than Russell Westbrook. And it's like you glossing over that and acting like it's no big deal that he jumped on a bandwagon for the team that beat him. I would not have had any problem with Kevin Durant going anywhere except to the team that knocked them off.
If that team had won a championship, I agree with you. They did not. I don't think it's a big deal that you collapsed in the Western Conference Finals and then go join that team. Had the Warriors won 73 games, defended their title, back-to-back champions, beaten Cleveland, and Durant goes there, that's weak. But just to survey the landscape and say, I think I have the best chance not only to win, but to play the kind of basketball that I believe is winning basketball, is more egoless basketball, I'm not going to fault him for that. And by the way, you and I are on the same page. Durant's better than Westbrook. However, Stephen A., let's not pretend that the world hadn't changed. When Durant got hurt and Westbrook was the sole real option on that team, he elevated his game. He became MVP caliber, and it was not clear. You and I may agree about it, but there are plenty who would disagree that Durant was clearly better than Westbrook this past season, that it was clearly still Durant's team. I think Westbrook had elevated to the point that that was a question. I think it interfered with the way they ran that offense late in that series against OKC. Against Golden State.
Kevin Durant averaged 27 a game. He shot about 50% from the field. He shot nearly 40% from three-point range. He was clearly more efficient. And I don't know what you're watching.
Well, he's got to be more efficient.
But let me be clear. There is no one that thought that Russell Westbrook was better than Kevin Durant.
In what world
are you living in?
Oh.
Do I need to ban you from talking about the sport of basketball?
Oh.
Do I need
That's
to ban
simply
Kevin
untrue.
Durant is not better than Russell Westbrook?
I agree with you. There are those who would argue the point, including on ESPN, including the analytics guys on ESPN.
Oh, the hell with them.
He doesn't care about analytics.
I don't want to hear that.
What?
I don't want to hear
the smart guys. You don't want to hear from the smart people?
I don't want to hear about those are the same people that sit up there, and regardless of how Kobe struggled, they had him ranked 93.
And it was true.
No, it wasn't.
I'm gonna tell you why.
Because in the sport of basketball, when you're not playing with anybody and going up against pros, you're gonna look like garbage unless you're at your elite level. If you had put Kobe on a damn decent basketball team,
what? The problem with that argument is I can't disprove it. It's just just assertion. What you're saying is
it's not
the numbers. You're saying the numbers don't count. Well, Kobe was really inefficient, et cetera, et cetera. Well, that doesn't count. Yeah, but the eyeball test said he wasn't good. And then you say, because he's not playing with good players.
And
then if he would have been playing with good players, you'd have another excuse.
Kobe's damn near 40 years old.
Right.
He was the number one option. You had Roy Hibbert and Clarkson and Swaggy P.
Are you saying Kobe wasn't the 90? He was better than the 93rd player last year?
Not at all. Yes, I am.
Oh,
I'm saying this to you because I'm not going by the numbers. I'm going by his situation. If you put Kobe on a decent
run.
If you put Kobe on a decent team, he would have looked better than he looked.
Okay.
Don't act like he was playing with a team.
You know how much better he had to be a good player?
But what I'm asking you is this. You're trying to gloss over and ignore the fact that the brother won 5 rings and he did what he did.
Oh.
I mean, come on now.
Now you're switching the argument. I'm not saying Kobe's not one of the greatest players of all time. I'm saying last year he wasn't good.
Last year he was awful. But what I'm saying to you is that it had a lot to do with the scrubs you were playing with.
And a lot to do with the fact that he had catastrophic injury in the not-too-distant past. And a lot to do with the fact that he's just old.
You're getting open shots and you don't have to work as hard as you have to work if you got teammates around you. Why did Kevin Durant leave for Golden State? It was because of the collection of talent was joining.
But not because he was shooting 38% from the floor or whatever it was.
I agree with that.
The idea that players, when they're not good, are still good because they were once good is far-fetched.
No. That's not my argument. Don't try to flip the script. My argument is that if you're playing with subpar players, then defenses get to key on you more and make you look worse than you are because you're not what you used to be, and you can't circumvent your way around that.
I would only add one word.
Mm-hmm.
Make you look even worse than you are, because he played worse.
Stephen A., quick question for you here. Will Westbrook ultimately regret this extension?
I don't think so.
Think it was the right choice?
Because I think if Westbrook wants out, he's going to be able to get out, especially since they added that additional year. He gets his money, plus Sam Presti will be in a position to move him to somebody else who may be willing to take the chance on him, even if they're not sure he'll want to stay there long term. But in the end, this move, he's going to look like a hero to the folks in Oklahoma City, and he should, because he's willing to stay at least an additional year in all likelihood. And in the end, what it comes down to is that Kevin Durant and a roundabout way was saying, I don't believe I can win with this guy. I tried it long enough. And who's to say he's wrong? He may not be wrong. But considering how much he came to the defense of Russell Westbrook time and time and time again, he could have sat back and kept quiet as opposed to coming to his defense like you completely believed in him, when it is clear now that was not the case.
I think it's legitimate for media members to say, time out, Durant. You've been taking this position for so long, aggressively going at us when we ask you questions. And then when it came time to examine your behavior said the exact opposite of what you've been saying.
That's the bottom line.
I think that's a legitimate
point. That's the bottom line.
You guys came out of the gates firing. This crowd all fired up here. We are just getting started. Right from Richmond, Virginia here. First take, day 3 of our training camp tour. This next conversation is going to be very interesting and very fitting for where we are. There you can see in the merchandise store, Redskins camp. A subject of controversy has been the name Redskins. You don't want to miss Max's take when we come back. Stay here.
All right. Let's see.
Oh, how about this? Yeah, we got a good crowd. You can see they're out there playing a little catch. D'Angelo Hall is out there. He will be joining us later along with Kirk Cousins and Josh Norman. Ryan Clark joining us now. Ryan, you played here for 3 years. Super Bowl champ Ryan Clark also joining us for this conversation.
He didn't win a Super Bowl with the Redskins.
I know. He won with the Steelers.
Let's make
sure. Okay, Steelers fan. Thank you. Thank you for clarifying that all of us. Welcome back in. Thank you guys for being with us. Stephen A., Max Kellerman also here. So since we're in Virginia, obviously a conversation, important conversation that's been discussed, controversial topic, is the name Redskins. So we want to dive into the actual name here. Team owner Dan Snyder has stuck by the name even when coming under fire for the use of it, which many people deem racist, as it refers to Native Americans. Max, tell us how you feel about the name Redskins.
Well, first of all, I won't use the name. And I think people, especially from cultures of the oppressed, should relate to this. But even if you're not from that, just as an empathetic human being, you should also try to understand it. Now, there's a poll in the Washington Post that said 90% of Native Americans polled are not offended by the name. First of all, the methodology has been questioned by an offended Native American tribe, has questioned the methodology. But even besides that, let's say the poll is accurate. I'm not worried about the 90% who are not offended. I'm worried about the 10% who are. Now, recently, the origins of the name have been uncovered. Originally, people thought that it referred to the scalp, right? The red under the scalp.
Yep.
And it had this kind of disgusting origin. And recently it was found that's not even the case, that Native Americans referred to themselves yes. that way as they referred to Europeans as white-skinned, Africans as black-skinned, etc. But I'm not worried about whether or not the origins of the name are pejorative. Over time, it came to be a slur. If you look it up in the dictionary, it will say a slur for Native Americans. Now, even if it wasn't a slur, can you imagine if a team was called the such-and-such whites or the such-and-such blacks? Because it doesn't refer to a single tribe. Mm-hmm. It refers to a word encompassing all Native Americans. I also would be uncomfortable with that. Furthermore, there are words that we used for black people that were not considered pejorative decades ago, like Negro, for instance, which today have taken on a negative connotation. Certainly it's not politically correct, and certainly you would feel uncomfortable calling a team by that name. So culture changes meaning over time. Just imagine for a second those who disagree with me. Of the Native American child in this country who comes from a household where the culture of the household does consider that a slur. And that Native American child is looking at his NFL team saying the NFL team is okay and the NFL by connection is okay with saying this word about me and my culture and who I'm from and my family. I think what this really boils down to, because I don't think this is that hard to understand, is Dan Snyder is a billionaire. Billionaires don't like to be told what to do. They're not used to it. And so, of course, when the Washington Post poll came out, he doubled down. We will never, all caps, change the name. Where's my camera? I want to just tell Dan Snyder something. That I'm disappointed in you, but I will be proud of you when the day comes, because it's coming, where you will be at the podium announcing the name change, because that will happen.
Listen, I've been here.
Yeah.
I played for the Redskins for 3 years. I've been around Dan Snyder, and you talk about a man being a billionaire. This doesn't come from billionaire Dan Snyder. This comes from Washington fan Dan Snyder. If you've been around him and seen the way he is with his players, seen the way he is about this team, he's not about this team as in I'm here to make money off of them. He's here because he loves this franchise. He loves the players on the team. So for him, he's looking at it from the fan point of view. When you started talking, you could hear the fans kind of going against you or opposing some of the things you said. And that's exactly the way Dan Snyder feels. I agree with you in the sense that if it offends anybody and it can be changed, I think you should look into changing it. The NFL isn't going to make Dan Snyder change the name. It's going to have to be on him. And as long as he feels this way, there isn't going to be a change in this, because he's not looking at it from all the ways you just explained, which I agree with. You think about the 10% that are offended. You think about those who don't even believe the poll was conducted in a way to where it is telling and true as to how the Native Americans feel. If you look at it that way and you're a man that empathizes with them or even sympathizes with them, you think you can change the name, because names change. If you look at the origin of the name, it started as the Braves when they were in Massachusetts. And then you move to Washington and you change the name. But for where we are as a society, they don't see that as bad. Many of you remember when Monty Jones went on the Mike and Mike show.
Yep.
And his shirt said Caucasian. Mm-hmm. Right? When that was done, there was a reason he had to eventually zip it up. Because the people who make the decisions aren't Native Americans. We talked about it yesterday. The people who make the decisions aren't African Americans. They are rich, Caucasian males. And until they start to feel differently about these things, things won't change. And we can sit up here and talk about it as much as we want. We want to. They will not change.
Particularly when you don't have leadership from the commissioner's office on issues like this in the form of Goodell. Hard to imagine Adam Silver not taking a much more active stance about this.
That's a funny point. It's great, though. It's such a double standard.
It's different in the NFL, right? Your bonus check comes from making those dudes money. Like, you're saying leadership by Roger Goodell, he doesn't lead them. Let's get that out of the equation. Let's stop talking about it. When they were sitting across from the table negotiating during the lockout, if they said something off the wall to the players, Roger was not, oh, hold on. When Jerry Jones got upset and moved from the table and said he was leaving and went stood by the door, Roger wasn't like, hey, come sit down back at the table and talk to these men. He doesn't lead them. He doesn't rule them. He doesn't get to tell them what they are going to do, because he won't be renewed. He won't get that bonus. So until these owners, now if other owners put pressure on him, but guess what they are too? Billionaire white men.
Who don't like being told what to do, Ryan.
Look, we have to be real and honest about something that's very, very important here. Max, I hear all your points. They can't be disputed for the most part. I agree with you. And as far as I'm concerned, you know, I hearken back, and I've said this on many occasions, thinking about the late Jack Kent Cook being interviewed by the late, great George Michaels, a dear friend, a mentor, a great man, particularly here in the Washington, D.C. area, George Michaels Sports Machine, when he was interviewing him. And Jack Kent Cook was like, I ain't changing anything. And then he interviewed George Michaels, interviewed Charles Mann. And Charles Mann was like, if it offends one person, that should be enough. Daniel Snyder and owners beg to differ. Here's where it gets tricky and it gets dicey. And we have to be honest about this. If you uttered the N-word, what African-American do you know that will look at a white person and say, you know, it's all right? You ain't gonna find too many of those. It's universally recognized that it is highly offensive. The problem with the Redskins name or anybody or anything like that as it pertains to Native Americans is that they seem to be divided amongst the ranks. When you do polls and you find out a certain segment of the Native American populace doesn't find it offensive, whereas there are more who do, they seem more divided and not as universal in their thinking and their belief as African Americans are with the N-word, as Jewish folks are with certain things that are considered anti-Semitic. The list goes on and on. It's that universal mentality that ultimately permeates, because if the entire Native American community stood up in unison and there was no divide, and Chris Cooley or Daniel Snyder or somebody else couldn't put a poll together where there is a large segment of folks out there who happen to be Native American who did not feel that it was offensive, then there was no argument. There's no argument that Daniel Snyder can make. But it's the fact that you're able to lean on a segment of the Native American populace who don't find it offensive, who have come out front and center and said they don't find it offensive, that they don't deem it as racist. Okay. That's where it's problematic. I'm only making that point, Max, to say this. I believe that if a large segment of a populace says it's offensive, that should be enough. But it's hard for me to engage in a level of condemnation as much of a disenfranchised community as the Native Americans are in the United States of America. Nobody, not even African Americans, have been as squashed and reduced to the realms of irrelevancy, more so than Native Americans. It is indisputable. But having said all of that, if you're still able to find a lot of people within the Native American community who says that the Redskins name is not offensive, I'm not saying that you are wrong for feeling the way that you feel. What I am saying is Daniel Snyder is a little bit less wrong for feeling the way he feels when he's able to point to people from the Native American community that support his position.
First of all, the Native American community is not one community. It was many different nations representing diverse point of views. Much harder to kind of categorize them ethnically as one kind of cohesive ethnicity that will speak with one voice. First of all, no ethnicity speaks with one voice.
Right. Right?
But in particular, Native Americans, it's difficult. It's many different nations and tribes of Native Americans. Secondly, this country did a number on Native Americans, so part of the reality is Native Americans don't have a voice that other ethnic groups have, and making it even more difficult to really gauge
it. But the little bit of voice that they do have, it's somewhat divided. Like I said, you can't. Let me tell you something right now.
You could come up here and say there's a word that I'm, as a black man, I'm perfectly okay with people using, and you can second it.
What he's saying is that both sides. You can argue on both sides, and so everybody comes together in unison.
It's not, nothing's going to give unanimity, practically. But if you said, no, I'm okay with this word, and so did you, and so did other, but there was a segment of the African-American population that was deeply offended by it. I, as a socially conscious individual, would say, I'm okay that you feel that way, and I'm not a black man.
Listen.
But as a man, I'm not okay with using the word.
But that's you, though.
That's you. That's me, and this
that's
is my
you.
Point
and
of
you
view.
Also have to understand,
and
they
this
don't
is the point of view of many people.
Negative though, like Daniel Snyder doesn't see it as negative. You see it as negative if we do. So you empathize with. That's not how he sees the name. He sees it as a name, and he said it. It was a name that was meant to honor the Native Americans,
no.
And he believes
do
that.
You see it as negative?
I see it as negative if the Native Americans do.
Do you see it as
if
negative?
I see it as negative. Yes, I do. But the flip side again is the listen.
We're talking about it not being a name
here's
anymore.
The deal. Here's the deal. You can say whatever you want. I'm trying to tell you, for all the white folks out there that want to sit up there and talk about, well, you know, in the communities, I mean, there's white folks that can sit up there and use the N-word with black folks. Go ahead and do it. I dare you. I double dare you.
And by the way,
watch what happened. Because universally, nationwide, if not worldwide, you use that word is going to be a problem. There are words that you can use in the Jewish community. Universally, they're going to have a problem with it. Even in the gay community. I remember that I talked to our colleague, LZ Grandison, and I said, one of my issues was, I said, we understand that the F word is highly offensive, but could you highlight for me what else is universally offensive so we'll make sure we know? The problem with the Redskins and the Native American community is that there's a populace within the Native American community that's saying we don't find it
Stephen
offensive
a?
At all.
Stephen
that
a?
Gets very tricky.
Stephen
it
a?
Gets tricky.
The NAACP, that's colored persons, right? If that was not an African-American organization, I would have a problem with it, wouldn't you?
What you mean?
Why is Dan Snyder or someone who is not from that group making that decision if there are members of the offended group who are offended?
Because it has to be.
It has to be unanimous.
It has to be as close to universal as you possibly get. When you talk about the NAACP,
so.
The National, you know, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, there are plenty of white folks who are members of the NAACP.
Yes. Sure.
But here's the reality: white, black, Hispanic, whomever's a member of the NAACP, they have one vision, they have one voice, they are lockstep in unison in terms of
colored,
their belief. They're not divided. They're not divided.
The word "colored" is not as offensive, obviously, as the N-bomb. And
right.
Some might even say, no, because I'm from an era where that
I
was...
Wish it was
that,
I wish it was a different
the
name.
The point is, we know what that is, and it's certainly, at the very least, politically incorrect, and culture has changed over time, and I'm not worried about the etymology of the word or the origins of the word. I'm worried about the little Native American kid who is offended by his football team's name, and it's got to change.
Well, I would say this to you. This is like the fifth time in 2 weeks you've been very, very concerned about the kids.
That's
the
right.
Children.
I got three kids.
Let me say this to you, and I applaud that. I'm a dad myself, but let me be very, very clear. If that is your concern, you're going to have a long life, bro. Because a lot of positions we take on various issues, kids are watching. But you believe what you believe, and there's a segment of that populace out there that do not find that word offensive. So to me, it's an issue that the Native American community have to find a way to come more together on, as opposed to looking for
guys,
people outside of their community to do it for them.
We got to leave it there. And yes, maybe that would create some change. But in 2016, it is still hard to believe that a team name is after a shade of someone's skin
color.
Look
it up in
regardless.
The dictionary. It says slur for Native Americans in the dictionary.
Well, When we come back from Richmond, Virginia, Ryan Clark is staying with us. Yes, he spends a lot of time there. Will Michael Vick be back on the field next season? We'll discuss. And could it possibly be in Dallas? That is the question. More First Take from Washington camp. Didn't know what to say there. Welcome back into Redskins camp here in Richmond, Virginia. The First Take training camp tour rolls on, and we're there. He is Kirk Cousins. You like that? He will be joining us later along with Josh Norman, D'Angelo Hall. Stephen A. loves when he says you like that. It's one of his favorites. He's just shaking his head at me right now, but we're so excited to be here. Great crowd, and a bunch of the Redskins team will be joining us in just a bit, but we want to focus here on Michael Vick. He's ready to make a comeback for one last time, according to our Josina Anderson. Vick, who played for the Steelers last season, said he's training in Florida, running longer distances than usual, and he believes he's faster than he's been in 2 to 3 seasons. Quote, this is the last year for me, and I'm going to wait it out, he said. Ryan, I want to start with you. Which team should take a chance on Michael Vick?
Well, if you're a team that doesn't have a proven backup, you know, he's already spoke about the Cowboys. And if you look at that team with Dak Prescott now being your main backup, a guy whose skill set in college was very similar to Michael Vick. He's probably not faster than Michael Vick. He was a 4.8 guy coming out last year. He doesn't know as much or doesn't have the experience that Michael Vick has. So you look at the Cowboys, and that seems like a fit. But if you have a team with a young quarterback, you know, you might think, okay, you lose Foles, maybe the St. Louis Rams. If you have a team with a young quarterback, you don't want the pressure of a Michael Vick in camp. So he has to go to a team with a proven quarterback that you feel like doesn't have a backup who can step right in and play and produce for this team along with getting you wins. But I don't necessarily want to talk about the team that's the best fit. Let's talk about what Michael Vick would need to be a successful backup. If you look at last year in Pittsburgh, they said he was great in the locker room, really good for guys who had been through things and were coming out of things, and able to give them wisdom and impart experience on how to be a better person. But if you look at him on the field, the one reason I think Antonio Brown doesn't have 2,000 yards is because of games Michael Vick played in. Michael Vick needs time. He needs the right type of play calling. He needs a team to adjust to him. So when you look at that and trying to figure out what team he fits on, where can he go, he has to go somewhere with a creative OC who understands that when it's Michael Vick time, we can't run Ben Roethlisberger plays. When it's Michael Vick time, we can't run Tony Romo plays. And I think that really shortens the list for you when you're a team looking for a quarterback that's not just based on his talent, the fact that he might still run 4 or 5, or the fact that he can throw it as far as you want him to throw it, is if you look at the games with Le'Veon Bell, the games with Antonio Brown, who we know is uncoverable, he didn't look good to me last year. And so I think the learning curve for somebody like him shouldn't be as deep or as long as it is for Michael Vick, but he needs to get somewhere now if he's going to be effective.
I think when you're talking about backup quarterbacks, you're talking about the best available guy. And I'm looking at the Dallas Cowboys right now. And McCown, I think, is a better pick. But you have to give something up for Josh McCown. It costs you resources in a league where there are intentionally limited resources. It's going to cost you something. So maybe it's still worth it if the price is right, you get McCown. Now, if you can't, Michael Vick just costs you the dough, and it ain't going to be that much. And now the question is, how is he as a backup? Look, his QBR last year was low. It was low. It was still higher than Nick Foles, by the way, who just got a job. But it was low. However, Michael Vick, as a starter, went 2-1 on a playoff team. You know, and here's the thing. I know there are a lot of dog owners in this country, and they can't get over Vick's moral transgression of the past. And that's legitimate. If you can't, you can't. That's on you. You have to make that decision for yourself. However, he has paid his debt through the legal system, the NFL, and the question becomes, if a guy gets a second chance, do you really give him that second chance? Does he start, if not with a clean slate, then at least with a chance to show you that he has reformed himself? And I think if you look at Vick's behavior on and off the football field and in the locker room, I mean, if that isn't a guy who's trying to make the most out of his second chance, I don't know what is. So I understand that the brand of the Cowboys, Stephen A., is a tough one to take on a Michael Vick, another guy with a troubled past. On the other hand, if you're looking for a backup and you don't want to give up resources and you see he could get it done still on the NFL level and he's the best available guy, I say roll with Vick.
Couple of things I'd like to say before I get to my point. Number one,
I don't want to hear anything about Michael Vick's past.
I agree.
He paid his debt to society, and more importantly than that, the NFL is in no moral position to judge anybody. I understand that there are people that have engaged in criminal activity that have not done things as egregious as Mike Vick did with the whole dogfighting scandal. But they didn't serve 18 months in the federal penitentiary either. And they didn't change their life around and become the epitome of redemption that he has become. I don't want to hear that. That's point number one. Point number two, I don't want to hear about Michael Vick being a member of the Dallas Cowboys, because Michael Vick is a good man. Michael Vick has changed his ways, and he's an unbelievable human being. And I don't believe that anybody who's overcome what he has overcome needs to contaminate themselves by having to wear a Dallas Cowboy uniform and being associated with that organization. Nobody deserves that after going through what Michael Vick went
through. I didn't see that coming.
Okay.
Me neither. That's the reverse of what I thought about.
I saw it coming.
That's number two. Number three. Now let's get to this. Michael Vick could be ideal for someplace like Denver. You know, experienced team, leaning on their defense, not expecting much from their offense. That's the team that comes to my mind. It would be ideal for him. As a person, do I want Michael Vick to end up in a situation like that? Absolutely. But I must confess to you, even though I'm wishing the best for him and I hope that he gets it, does he deserve it? The answer is no. And here's why. Atlanta and then the New York Jets, those are two destinations where he's openly admitted that at one time or another, he was ill-prepared for the job at hand because he didn't take the job seriously. In the case of Atlanta, he was feeling himself. In the case of the New York Jets, because he came there to be a backup, right. Mm-hmm. He wasn't prepared. You can't be a quarterback on an NFL level assigned to potentially be a backup with a history of literally not being prepared due to a dereliction of duty, but have us on national television singing about how you should get an opportunity. I hope he does, because he's a good man. And I wish him well, because he deserves it after paying his debt and turning his life around. It's an unbelievable story. But strictly from the perspective of an NFL executive, why should I take a chance on you when your QBR was 31, the season before that it was 21 with the New York Jets, and on top of it all, primarily due to a dereliction of duty because you didn't take the job seriously enough?
I'll tell you why. First of all, it's a great point. If you want to stand on principle, that's a great point. But we just acknowledged that Vic is an example of a person who can actually change. Over time, he can change, make dramatic and lasting changes in his life for the better. Now, in the case of his first run with Atlanta, he did not optimize what he had there in his talent. In the case of the Jets, he foolishly, though he was getting his life together, he foolishly didn't prepare because, as you said, Stephen A., he thinks he's going to be a backup anyway, and that's no excuse. But we've seen a guy make progress in his personal life. Mm-hmm. We've seen a guy rally the troops, and Ben Roethlisberger comes on the field, and he throws the winning pass and overcomes San Diego on Monday Night Football, kind of rallies the team. What makes us think that he can't again learn
and get better again? For me, it's not about being able to change.
That's right.
For me, it's about what I saw on the field, whether it be the New York Jets or the Pittsburgh Steelers. Mm-hmm. It's about him looking like he didn't know where the ball should go. And we've seen
you're
people
looking at it like the one
backup quarterback.
That's it about you. I get both of your points. My point is, if I'm an NFL executive, mm-hmm. do I risk my stature by taking the chance on somebody who literally was derelict in his duties
and
as
didn't prepare in the past? And we have to go to break, but that reminds me of D'Angelo Williams yesterday, who stepped in for Le'Veon Bell, said he prepared for a full 16, and then he led the league in rushing touchdowns at a 33-year-old running back, and because he took it so seriously. Last season was one most fans of teams in the NFC East would like to forget, right? The Redskins took the division title with only 9 wins. Listen to this. There hasn't been a repeat champion in the division since the Eagles did it from 2001 to 2004. So the question to you, Max Kellerman, Who do you see as the biggest threat to dethrone Washington? Excuse me.
Would you like me to give Max his answer now before he even starts?
I'm a homer. Go ahead.
The New York Giants.
It's actually the New York Football Giants.
The New York Football Giants. You're damn right.
You got football in there.
Look, I'm a homer. That's right. I am a homer. Forgive me. I've seen a lot of Giants Super Bowl wins in my life for being a homer. Look. The Giants last year had epic collapses at the end of games. It was uncharacteristic of them. Characteristically, in the Eli Manning era, they played very well at the end of games. Maybe the law of averages caught up. Maybe Coughlin had lost the team by then, and obviously he's gone. But if you end games with 75 seconds left last year, they got 10 wins. Well, if. Yeah. But what that indicates is fundamentally, they were much better than their record. They collapsed at the end. Don't expect the Giants to collapse at the end of games again this year, especially Spagnuolo's back, McAdoo, new head coach, the whole thing. Things will be different. They have invested, much like the Cowboys did, though not as severely, not as emphatically, in their offensive line in recent years. When you look at draft picks, they do Richburg and obviously Flowers recently, etc. And offensive line play takes time to gel. They come together over time. It's a lot about communication and chemistry and everything. They have that. But here's the big thing. In a quarterback league, Eli Manning, who, by the way, according to various studies, is the most clutch quarterback in the history of postseason play in the NFL. It's according to 538.com. Doing it two different ways. He also, knock wood, takes every snap. So even if you want to argue Romo is better game to game, I won't even argue. Is Romo available? And Kirk Cousins is a fine young quarterback. Are you sure about Kirk Cousins going forward? You've seen him do it for a small sample size. And don't even talk about the Eagles right now, what they have under center. Stop Bradford and you draft guys. But Eli Manning, and who's he throwing the ball to? Odell Beckham Jr. And now you got Sterling on the other side. The Giants are clearly the threat in the NFC East.
Well, first of all, for the record, you ain't debating them. You're debating me. You can look over there all they want you. They can't help you.
He just has to get the reaction from all the Redskins fans out here. They can't help you.
That's number one. That's number one. Number two, I just want to make sure that I'm clear for clarity purposes. Ryan, I'll lean on you. Did Max Kellerman just say that the pieces are there and, you know, he bragged about McAdoo and he bragged about Spagnuolo? This is for the same Giants team that had a losing record for the last 3 years, has missed the playoffs the last 4 years.
Yes.
And the only thing they changed was their head coach.
Yes.
I mean, this is the same team. I just wanted to make sure. Now that we got that out the way, let's be clear about something here. We got Janoris Jenkins. We got Damon Harrison, who's great against the run. They drafted Eli Apple out of Ohio State. Olivia Vernon. We get all of that. Their secondary should be good. Their defensive line should be better in terms of getting at the passer, because they couldn't do anything until JPP arrived with one hand, albeit. So we got all of that going on. I get that. I understand that, combined with the fact that the Giants paid $200 million on the defensive side of the ball in the offseason to make that happen. I understand the elevated level of confidence. But I gotta admit to you, and you know I'm serious about this, because it makes me sick to my stomach, what I'm about to say.
I believe
that the Dallas Cowboys are gonna win the NFC East. I really believe that. And it was why, you know. I don't care.
Let me be very clear
about this. When you think about Ezekiel Elliott and what he can do running the ball and catching the ball out of the backfield, the fact that your own Alfred Morris is now with them, when you look at Des Bryant coming back, when you look at Tony Romo coming back, their defense is going to be suspect. Of course they are. But I think the NFC East, unlike any other division, maybe outside of the AFC North, are pros at beating up on one another. And somebody comes out on top, bruised and battered and mediocre nevertheless, but still out on top. And I think this year, because of Romo and Bryant's return, assuming they stay healthy, I think that they win the NFC East. I'm not sold on the Giants, because even though their defense will be vastly improved because of what I remembered, they were so god-awful last year. I mean,
They were 75 seconds away, 40 and 10
defensively,
wins.
Defensively, they were one of the worst defenses in history.
That's when you make your money.
That's going to happen again?
So you go on one hand, the end of the game doesn't matter. But on the other hand, in the playoffs, Eli is so clutch. Like,
well,
which
I'm
I'm saying, if throughout a guy's whole career, he's money in the fourth quarter, and then one year there's a hiccup,
Eli's been money for two playoff runs.
Oh, he's good in the fourth quarter,
period. Which is only one more playoff run than Joe Flacco.
Joe Flacco's an excellent quarterback.
Joe Flacco's a good quarterback.
And how many good runs has Tony Romo had in the playoffs?
He's a good quarterback. Hey, listen.
Yep.
We're not talking about the playoffs. We're talking about this season.
Can you rely on Tony Romo to make it through a season?
The biggest threat to Washington is going to be Washington. It is theirs to lose. It is theirs to lose. If Kirk Cousins continues to be the Kirk Cousins we saw over the end of the season, which I believe with Jordan Reed, with DeSean Jackson, Crowder, Pierre Garçon, he can be. The best left tackle in football plays here, is practicing in Richmond. If these guys stay healthy, I believe the depth is a problem here. But on paper, the people that go out on the field first, the first 22, if the Washington Redskins do what they have to do, they will win.
But let me say this. I believe in Kirk Cousins' ability as a quarterback. My question about the Redskins is that the Redskins won 9 games last year. Not one win was against a winning team. Not one. And so, to me, the question remains, is it fool's gold, or is it fraudulent, or are they legit? Their schedule will be tougher this year. Kirk Cousins is playing for a new contract this year. But there are question marks about this team. Got DeSean Jackson and Pierre Garçon playing for a new contract. Obviously, you got Doxson, who's a baller. We'll see what he does. All the pieces remain in place. We know that the Redskins, on paper, should be the team. But when have been the Redskins' worst years? When they've had expectations.
And the other thing, that's my issue.
Problem is winning the offseason championship. They didn't really do that this year. They got Josh, but it wasn't about adding
a
lot of pieces.
Free agent.
Right, it wasn't. But it came up late, and they said they wanted a corner. What you don't understand, this guy Breland.
On paper, the starters, you're right. The secondary, for example, goes from suspect to very impressive, potentially on paper. Stephen A's point about the rivalries in the NFC East is true. It really means something. There's no matchup in the NFC East that's meaningless. All those teams have long and storied rivalries. Mm-hmm. They all get up for each other. I think it's the reason that even when there's a definitive advantage in talent on one side, the NFC East seems to be evenly matched. It seems that any given Sunday, anything can happen. I think that prevents anyone, including this Washington team, which you're right, the starters on paper, very impressive, from running away with it. So then you start to look at other factors, like, for example, strength of schedule. I seem to remember the Giants taking a team that came very close to winning the Super Bowl to the bitter end of that game. The Giants, even when they lost games, were losing to quality teams at the last minute. And again, in a quarterback league, let's go over the quarterbacks. You may have something in Kirk Cousins here, but the jury's still out. Tony Romo, game to game, may be the best performer, but I do not think you can rely on him to be there every week. And Sam Bradford, come on. And then you draft the guy who you hope is going to be something eventually. Yeah. But the Giants have 2-time Super Bowl MVP.
Very true.
Eli Manning under center.
Who's also led the league in interceptions 3 times.
Yeah, that's usually.
I'll say,
usually, if you break it down, that's usually not always on Eli, who has a very complex, at the time, offense to run.
And a lot of responsibility. Because he wasn't running around right. And we get all of that. But the flip
and
side.
And the offensive line was porous.
Wait a minute. And it's still a suspect right now.
Everybody here is suspect, though.
That's why you go with Washington and you say they didn't have a win against winning teams. Mm-hmm. Because everybody in the NFC East was terrible. You play those guys 6 times, and now
that's why they're not going to run away.
And now your schedule gets a little harder this year because you're the number one team in the East, which means you play the number one team in each division in your conference. That will make it harder. But nobody's going to run away with this division, and I think when it comes down to it, when the games get tight, which they do in the end, when you have division games, that this team is more talented than the teams they will be playing to see who represents this division in the playoffs. I'm going with Washington.
Only one playoff team out of this division?
Only one.
Yeah.
Only, only one. I agree with that.
It's only one.
And I think that the Eagles will be in last place. With the Dallas Cowboys, listen, I hope I'm wrong because we know I ain't rooting for them.
Yeah.
But the reality is that I think Dez and Romo together make up for a lot. The Washington Redskins, to me, you know, they're unproven because of who they beat. That we got to decide whether they're fraudulent or not. And a lot of that is going to have to do with Kirk Cousins because I have no doubt about a healthy DeSean Jackson and a Pierre Garçon and a Dotson. And Jordan Reed is a stud. He's a stud. I love Jordan Reed. We'll see what happens. But it remains to be seen because the Redskins are one of those teams who have been allergic to prosperity in terms of expectation. I got to see them now that they don't get to sneak up on you. And you know they're coming, what they're going to
By
do.
By the way, you keep talking about DeSean Jackson and Kirk Cousins. That's a tremendous combination. No one can get behind the defense. Like he puts one move on you, DeSean Jackson's gone.
So,
but actually, the best, most reliable quarterback in the league who won two Super Bowls, Eli. The best receiver in the division is Odell Beckham. He's better than Dez, and he's better than DeSean Jackson, and he's better than anyone on the Eagles. And he's the best. So in a vertical passing league, you have the best home run threat on a team that's been there and done that. And just like the Cowboys' offensive line kind of snuck up on people, all of a sudden it's like that was a liability. Damn, they kept drafting top of the draft with offensive linemen. They're pretty good. These years, and it could be this one, mm-hmm. the resources the Giants have put in the draft to the O-line is going to pay dividends.
I feel you. That sounds very, very emotional. It's beautiful. I'm very touched. But I will tell you that it says something to me that despite the $200 million that they paid for the defensive side of the ball, improving their defensive line, improving their secondary, drafting Eli Apple as well, which I hope is going to work out well for them, it says something to me that the Giants' number one offseason priority was keeping a one-armed bandit in JPP, Jason Pierre-Paul. That was what they said their number one priority was. That was their number one priority.
He had a great season.
Listen, he was at a damn good season.
Yeah, I just have one thing to say in conclusion. I think you'll agree. Big Blue!
Yeah, go Big Blue.
Oh, my goodness.
Really?
All right, this is how Vegas sees it, in case you want to know. Giants and Cowboys tied to win the division, followed by the Redskins and the Philly. Not corny. Go Big Blue. Back here at Redskins camp in Richmond, Virginia for our 2016 training camp tour. And now we move into a topic that is very near and dear to Stephen A's heart. So Seahawks defensive end Michael Bennett shared his feelings. Look at that face right there. That Jay Cutler is the worst quarterback in the NFL, he said in this piece in ESPN, the magazine. And then his brother Martellus went on to explain when he was wide open, Jay Cutler would throw into double coverage and he was available ready on the field in another part, of course. Cutler responded on Wednesday. Take a listen.
I don't know. I'm really not going to get into that. Most receivers and tight ends are always open. So, you know, hopefully Tom, I guess, can do a better job of finding them than I did.
Oh, Stephen A., like, love, or hate Jay Cutler's response?
I like it. I respect it from the standpoint that he didn't want to get into the muck and mire of it all. So I can understand that. But I also think I like it because he showed some wisdom. What could he say? Let me be very, very clear. Jay Cutler's the worst quarterback in football. I want to be very, very clear about that. The worst. Let me explain. The worst. Because I'm not talking about his talent. I know he's got arm strength. I know he's got athletic ability. I know that he's tough. Last time I checked, people out there, I watched Mike and Mike this morning with Ryan Russillo and Mike Golick. I've listened to people on talk radio. I hear all of these folks in Chicago and beyond bloviating about Jay Cutler. They know he has some hiccups. Nobody's lying about him. Please don't get me wrong. I'm not casting aspersions on anybody. But they keep talking about his abilities. But when we sit back and we judge quarterbacks, what do we always talk about? We talk about intangibles. We talk about leadership. Where the hell is Jay Cutler's intangibles? Where the hell is his leadership? He is a quarterback. There is no quarterback in the NFL devoid of more leadership qualities than Jay Cutler. He walks around looking depressed all the time. The only time I've ever seen him smile is when he was signing a contract as if he was laughing at the organization and the city of Chicago and a collection of fools all over the United States of America who actually believed he deserved half the damn money he got. He stinks. And that's the bottom line. And he stinks because he has no leadership ability. He does not inspire. He does not galvanize. He does not bring people together. And this is how you need to know this. The new offensive coordinator, I think it's Loganes or Loggins, how you pronounce it, G-A-I-N-S, so I'm going to say Loganes. He's the new offensive coordinator that succeeded him, Adam Gase, who's now the head coach for the Miami Dolphins because of the job he did with Jay Cutler. Now, let's think about the job he did with Jay Cutler. Jay Cutler, did he have 40 touchdowns? No. He threw 21 touchdowns. He threw 11 interceptions. He had a QBR of 60, and you got people acting like, let's throw a parade for his sorry behind. He stinks, okay? And the bottom line is this. Not only is that a reality where they're sitting there and they're bloviating about Jay Cutler, but let's be clear. What you're doing is that offensive coordinator, Loganes, that is there now, the number one reason he got the job is because of his relationship with Jay Cutler. You know why his relationship with Jay Cutler is such a big, big issue? Because people usually don't have a relationship with him. The players he plays with, the players he throws to, the players he hands off the football to, nobody but Brandon Marshall speaks up for him, which is why Brandon Marshall no longer has credibility when he has something to say about quarterback. Because the fact that he would come front and center and speak on behalf of Jay Cutler immediately strips him of any credibility he has. We're talking about any quarterback whatsoever. My man Chris Carter, my former colleague here at ESPN, used to say Blaine Gabbert stinks. Well, he's saying that about Blaine Gabbert's ability. I'm not talking about Jay Cutler's ability. I'm talking about his lack of leadership. I'm talking about his selfishness. I'm talking about how distant he is. And I understand that there'll be people out there saying, I know it's type 2 diabetes, whatever it is. The way I look at it, we live in an advanced society where there's medicine everywhere to help you out. I think it goes a bit deeper for Jay Cutler than just that. I think he's who he is, he's always been that way, and he's laughing all the way to the bank with his family. He stinks, he doesn't need to be anybody's starting quarterback, and it's a damn shame that he's actually a topic on this show, because Jay Cutler stinks, period.
Well, I wouldn't say it's a shame after that he's a topic on the show.
Good,
I want to talk about Jay Cutler every day. You're wrong that he's the worst quarterback in the NFL. Look, you just said his QBR. I give you a whole list of guys with worse QBRs than Jay
Leadership.
Cutler. Okay, that is true.
And tangible.
We had Mike Tomlin on the show yesterday, and from the first word anyone has ever heard Mike Tomlin utter, you go, man, if I was a player, I would run through a brick wall for that guy. And with Cutler, you're like, man, if I was in a huddle, he couldn't inspire me to walk out of the huddle. Like, I get that. That's why that kind of component of his personality and the fact that he quit in the NFC Championship game, that undermines his value. Obviously, it lowers it from solid middle-of-the-pack kind of NFL quarterback, maybe even high average. It's a very competitive position, but he's a talented guy, to below average. He's a below average quarterback because of everything you just mentioned. But let's not pretend he's the worst. Like, I don't care how uninspiring he is. He's better than Nick Foles. I know Foles had a very good season under Chip Kelly, but if you watched Foles last year, you know Jay Cutler's better quarterback than Nick Foles. I want to talk about what he said directly, because he was criticized and Bennett said he's the worst quarterback in the league. I loved everything Cutler said about it, except for one thing. Because he took the high road. I loved it. Except for one thing. He said, all receivers always think they're always open. That was good. I'm like, okay, I'm with you.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe Tom Brady will have a better time connecting with him next year. And I thought, Jay, that's the dumbest thing you could say. You had me with you, because let me tell you something. Tom Brady will certainly have better success connecting with him.
That's why I don't think it matters.
Because he's the best quarterback who ever lived, and you're running a two tight end set with Gronkowski. Of course. So, like, why would you set yourself up where, in order to disprove that you're the worst, Tom Brady can't find the guy now?
Hey, but do we even care if he's the worst or not? Because we know he's not the best. Right. And but what we do know is that when you say something like this about a former quarterback, it's not about him being able to play or not. Because if you like a dude, you'll say something good about him, or you won't say anything at all. So it's more about the way he relates to his team. He talks to his teammates. I played with somebody who was with the Steelers, went to the Bears, and then came back to the Steelers. And so, you know, the question for me, because I'm nosy, hey, how's Jay Cutler? I can't tell you because in 2 years, we never had a conversation.
Wow.
This is a man that played offense, that he had to throw to, that had to block for him, and he never had a conversation with him. And so if you look at what he says, it's about what I think Jay Cutler would say anyway. He really didn't get into it. It really wasn't inspiring. It really wasn't anything that we should be talking about the exact words, because that's his life. Well, that's the way he acts on the sideline. That's the way he does his interview. I didn't expect him to combat it. And even if he said the thing about Tom Brady, I don't think that brings scrutiny on him, because we expect Tom Brady to find him anyway.
Well, I'll tell you where the scrutiny comes with the Tom Brady mention. Maybe. The word maybe. What do you mean maybe? Tom Brady on crutches could throw better than Jay Cutler.
Well, his arm still works, though.
Tom Brady muted. Tom Brady could have a bad case of severe laryngitis and be more of a leader than Jay Cutler. We are talking intangibles. We are not talking athletic ability. We're talking intangibles. A willingness to go out there, ingratiate yourself with the people you need in order to be successful and be a leader from that quarterback position. People who come to the defense of Jay Cutler, make up your mind how you feel about the requirements. And by the way, if you remember, First Take was supposed to be in Chicago on Monday. I don't know this. I haven't heard anything. This is my personal belief. Has nothing to do with ESPN. I believe that the Chicago Bears said no way in hell is First Take coming to Chicago, because if Stephen A. is in the same vicinity as Jay Cutler, who knows what Jay Cutler might try to do to him, because I tell him to his face, he stinks, because he's not a leader. He doesn't lead and galvanize troops. And on the NFL level at the quarterback position, that is exactly what you need in order to be successful. He is stealing money from the Chicago Bears. Stealing money. He should be arrested for theft.
All right, let's leave it there. You know who did welcome us? Richmond, Virginia, the Washington Redskins. Their signal caller, there he is over there, Kirk Cousins. Come on out, Kirk. He led his team to NFC East Championship status.
Now, I don't feel that way about that.
He will be with
what
us next.
Okay.
He's probably going to run man? After
good
that.
See you, bro.
More First Take after
right.
the break.
You should know you led it in shape.
Let's get it cracking. Let's start the session. March list the competition. Balls by that action. You can never debate it. This is actual fact. Stephen A. and Max Kale said they say it's a rap. I'm like, say what? Say what? What's up with all my haters? I'm a ball when I perform. Tell my jerseys in the air. I'm allergic to my haters. Every morning I prepare. A lot of clothes I can wear. Just like them Oregon players. Yeah, quack, quack. What it do? Rap like it's nothing to it. Matter of fact, you can ask hard and I'm cooking too. Base guard cooking too. Nah, look at you. Break mine. They embrace mine like a crooked tooth. Four takes. That's you. Three takes. Not me. Two takes. If you lucky, First Take, stop me. Four takes, that's you. Three takes, not me. Two takes, if you lucky, First Take, you got me.
You're watching First Take, presented by Bass Pro Shops.
The snap, Trey touchdown! Touchdown,
Redskins! You like that? You like that?
Cousins under center. He's going to throw it out to the left, looking for Garcon. It is caught! They are yelling, you like that? How about that?
I'm proud of y'all, man. I like that.
You like that?
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 You like that? You like that? I like that.
You got to like that, right?
You like that? Yeah, you like that?
You like that?
You like that?
Look what he started. You gotta love the passion. Our next guest led the Redskins to the NFC East title in his first season as captain of the offense. Kirk Cousins here with us on First Take. Thank you so much for making time. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thrilled to be on. Thanks for having me.
We know you like that. All right, let's start here with your contract. So no secret, you're playing under the franchise tag this season. You're betting on yourself. What are some of the positives, though, of playing under the tag?
Well, first of all, it's a great salary. I don't know many people who complain about that. I've got a great opportunity. My options are open at the end of the season. And I do feel in the NFL, every deal is a one-year deal. You've got to prove yourself each and every year. Otherwise, they're going to talk about letting you go. So whether it's a tag or a long-term deal, a two-year deal, you've got to go play well and prove it each and every game and each and every season.
A lot of respect for you for betting on yourself the way that you do. You deserve to be commended for that. Passed over 4,100 yards last year. what is it, 69% of your passes you completed. I'm wondering, yeah, though, without question, led the league. I'm wondering, how was it that you believe you were so successful last year, and why do you believe that can continue?
Well, it's no secret that a quarterback's as good as the guys around him, especially a young quarterback like myself. So when you got a play caller like Sean McVay putting you in a position to be successful, you've got skilled players all over the joint who can make plays for you and get open. You got great pass protection. It makes the job much easier. So I think it's a supporting cast, surrounding cast, including a coaching staff that's made it much, much better for me.
How much did Coach Gruden giving you the job before the season began contribute to your success, considering the fact that in the past it was you competing with RG3, and even when RG3 was hurt, you were in his shadow?
You know, it certainly gives you a position from which to lead, to have influence. You know, it helps now being the starter, even going into the offseason program. So even better then, because last year was kind of right before week one, named the starter. So I think when you can be given that opportunity, you're kind of given that green light to go ahead and lead and be authoritative, I think it does make a difference.
You did. That was a mean feat to take the job from a guy. I mean, injury, yes, whatever. But they invested an enormous number of resources in RG3. I mean, that was an enormous, and to just consider that a sunk cost, that means the guy who took the job, they have to really believe in. What does that do for you to start this season? You have not been in that position before.
Sure. No, everybody's looking for a chance to be believed in, for people to invest in them, to want them, to give them every opportunity to succeed. And I feel like, for me, that is this season. And I've been given a phenomenal chance, and now the ball's in my court to do something with it. But all you can really ask for is a chance, then you've got to make it happen.
Let me ask you this. You like that, which everyone's playing to death, including us. Now, on the one hand, it's great. It's catchy. Everyone said it. Everyone's saying it.
Confess, I never liked
no,
it.
Right. But like I have Kirk to confess. Knows.
But on the other hand, now you're the you like that guy until
right.
you do something else.
Exactly.
If you could do it again, would you have done it the same
exactly.
way or not?
Yeah, if I could do it again, I would do it just because it was who I am. I was being myself. It wasn't fake. I didn't even know a camera was there. So I like being genuine. I had no idea it was going to go the way it did, which says a lot about social media and the internet and media these days. But that being said, you know, I sure would like to be known for a lot more than three words, and that's what this season and future seasons is about.
Is that a question? Is that a rhetorical question at all, or was that a definitive statement telling us that we like that?
I've seen both versions with an exclamation point and a question mark, but I would say an exclamation point is the way I said it. I wasn't giving him a choice on whether or not he liked it. I was telling him he liked it.
Tricky question, perhaps, but must be asked. We watched RG3 last year on the bench in basically street clothes or a Redskins warm-up suit. It rubbed a lot of people like myself and others the wrong way, because we understand that the Redskins have to do what they have to do from a business perspective. But the reason I'm asking you about that is because this one-year offer, where you get an opportunity to prove yourself, I want to know what the mindset was behind that, because clearly the Redskins are about business. They showed that last year with RG3. How did that touch you in terms of thinking about your own future with this organization financially and beyond?
Yeah, I mean, it's not too complicated. I think the franchise offer was a great opportunity for me to go out and prove myself. Like I said, if I'm not good enough this season, I wasn't going to be around here long anyways. Like you said, they make business decisions, and you've got to play well and produce. So whether it's a one-year deal, a long-term deal, I knew I needed to play well, and I think the beauty of the franchise tag is if I do play well, I've got options at the end of the season. If I don't play well, I don't deserve to have a long-term deal anyways.
Kirk, you have a great line and some serious offensive weapons. Sean Jackson, who else? Jordan Reed, Matt Jones, Josh Doxon. A ton of them. What are you most excited about with this offense?
Well, we're going to have to spread it around, because there's going to come out of games where somebody who deserved to get the ball a lot probably didn't, because there's only one football and we got more than five or six weapons. So we got some work to do to spread it around. But I think the fact that there are so many weapons, injuries are bound to happen. You're probably going to lose somebody, but the depth that we have is going to make a big difference. And like you said, if we can have great line play and run the football well, that's going to open everything up as well. So, you know, football is no different than it was years ago. We got to run the football, protect the football, and if we do that, good things will happen.
Kirk Cousins, we appreciate you. You also got some pieces on defense. One's Josh Norman, who will be with us in just a minute. Thank you so much. Best of luck this season. We'll be watching.
Bad luck.
No, not bad luck.
On your house.
More First Take back in a moment from Redskins camp.
You're watching First Take, presented by Bass Pro Shops.
Portals is going to throw, intercepted. Norman may score. 20 down the left sideline, 15, 10. It is a touchdown. No flag. Josh Norman took it to the house.
Intercepted.
it. It's Norman.
Go ahead, young man. You do your thing.
How do you expect your transition to this defense to go?
Well, I think it's going to go well for me. I don't know. This is football. I don't put too much emphasis on anything. It's X's and O's. Your player against our best player, and we're going to see who's going to win.
Back here on First Take from Richmond, Virginia, dinner on this man. He made his name with the Carolina Panthers, got paid by the Redskins, the highest paid corner in the NFL. Josh Norman, thank you for being with us again.
Thanks, man. I appreciate
Congratulations
it.
On this deal, $50 million guaranteed. You heard me say highest paid corner in the NFL. What does that mean?
You got to keep going for more. Got to keep striving for be the best you can be. And that is just one of the, you know, stepping stones that God blessed me with to be able to accomplish. But I'm looking for more, you know. I'm looking for more to do. That's just one of the things that, you know, obviously he blessed me with. But I don't look at it as, you know, I have that because I don't feel like I still do because I work out here like I don't. So
we know you paid. You should be very, very happy about that. But we also know how much you loved Carolina. And how has it been being here, and how long were you shaken up about being about departing from Carolina?
Well, obviously, the human side of you, of course, is going to feel some type of way because you've been there all your life, you know? You're trying to build the organization and build there. You've seen it from the bottom up to the top. You know what I'm saying? Like, you've been in that. You had your hand in that. Yep. You helped mold that. And when you're not in it, dang, it just feels like a big, like gut punch. Like you help, like that's kind of your baby in a way, and the guys that you grew up with, you're not there no more. Of course there's gonna be that feeling. That's that human side of you. But at the same token, you gotta understand, was I growing there? Did God see me fit to stay there? He have other measures for me to go and expand and meet new people and help them out and grow in other places? Of course. And that's why, you know, Washington Redskins was a perfect fit for me because of what all they brought to the table and what I was looking for.
Now, I got messages today. Josh Norman's like, make sure he's there. Don't duck me. So I'm here.
In the flesh.
Why did you want me to make sure I was here?
No, I'm just, why do I want to make sure you want to hear it? I like how you're throwing that back at me, though.
Yeah. Had something to do with Odell Beckham comments.
Man, it ain't had nothing to do with none of that. I just think that to know to understand the position to how, you know, you guys was talking about me out here in the practice field getting beat up by a wide receiver on one-on-ones, and it's just, one-on-ones in practice.
I wasn't making a big deal out of that.
I mean, it's just like, gosh, it's World War III. Like, man, Bums of a Bad Dad out here. Like,
I wasn't making a big deal out of that. I don't think that's fair to you that a dude like DeSean Jackson puts one move on you in practice and it's all over the internet. That's not what I'm talking about.
So
what I'm talking about is the game against Odell, where it's like Josh Norman did a great job on him, and I give you credit, you're so competitive, I think you got into his head because he dropped what would have been a touchdown catch.
Okay, let's talk about that.
But he did beat you on the play.
Let's talk about that drop, okay?
Yeah.
First off, I'm going to go back and clarify that because everybody thought it was a man, which is not true.
All right.
And clarify, it was not man.
Right.
It's cover four. So in cover four, I'm looking outside.
Quarters.
And of course,
yep.
quarter, half. That's how you play it. So quarter safety is going to be there. But at the same time, I'm not passing no blame on nobody for what they do. I'm looking back at the quarterback. I see him break. I look back, nobody there. I'm running to go and catch him. And I said some things. Who knows what I'm saying? I'm not going to tell you on the field.
Okay.
But he ended up looking back and dropped the ball. But at the same time, that's on him. That's not on what I've done or anything like that. But at the same time, go back and watch film and see what coverage we're in. So for you to say that, and say, well, it was man on that play from everybody seeing that and how, he got beaten up. Check it out. Watch the full thing. Look back. I'm running,
right.
Speeding up. So it's not like we playing.
Can you play man on Odell? Listen, you're in the NFC East at that position. What you've been paid to do now is ridiculous when you consider the receivers in the division. Can you play man defense in this day and age with these rules and these receivers in your division?
Wow. Well, like I said, you probably have to go back and watch the film because that's what I've done when we played them last year. It's no different. I played the two guys in our division last year, Dez and Julio. Dez and Odell, both of them. So, and I played a man. So it's like for me, try to figure out Where is all this coming from?
Well, let me tell you where it's coming from. Let me answer that because we're running out of time. Let me answer that. You being paid the way that you are, with folks looking at the cornerback position, and you see a Richard Sherman, and you see a Patrick Peterson, and you see so many of these other guys, so many people trying to debate, and to some degree, the players themselves playing that position, debating who's the best, who's not, responsibilities. But Darrell Revis talked to us about getting up on a guy, bumping, you know, playing bump and run,
right,
manning up and following your man, as opposed to somebody that's subjected to zone schemes and playing that way. The pressure is on you with this team, who's the reigning defending NFC East champions, to step up and buffer that secondary even more. Do you feel that pressure, and do you embrace it?
Pressure burst pipes, and I don't have it. So do I feel pressure on myself? No. I'm not trying to come out here and prove that people are wrong. I'm trying to prove that I'm right. At the end of the day, I'm going to go out here and do what I do, play a physical style football. In your face, smash mouth. That's what we do. End of the day, I don't really care about what other people say. That's their own opinions, man.
Right.
Like, for me, everybody look like, oh, how did he get here? I'm an enigma to people. You know, I'm an enigma. People don't understand that. So they're trying to figure it out. And at the end of the day, I'm going to do what I got to do for my teammates, and we're going to be where we're going to be at after all said and done, because...
Well, last question, where you going to be at?
I don't care.
Last question, where you going
to
be at?
Well, shoot, man, we out here working, trying to get a ring. That's what we're out here for. If you ain't out here doing that, then you failing.
You just played with a team that went to the Super Bowl. You trying to say this team could go to the Super Bowl?
I'm saying we working towards our goal. That's what I'm saying.
Okay. And so you know where I am on you. I admire your competitiveness. I think it makes you an excellent player. But I don't think it's possible in this day and age to man cover the elite receivers. Not even a knock on you, even anybody is going to man cover. Unless it's Deion Sanders, right, these elite receivers.
So if they don't catch 100 yards, if they don't have to go over 100 yards, then what that is?
That's a good job in terms of scheming.
Thank you so much for being with us. Good luck this season. Congrats on everything.
Appreciate
your new home. Hope everything
goes
well. When we come back, his teammate on defense there. I see him. D'Angelo Hall, come on out. Up to the hot seat right now.
What's up,
more from Redskins camp. Stay here.
What's up, brother?
How are you?
First Take is presented by Bass Pro Shops. Your adventure starts here. And in part by T-Mobile. Ditch your carrier and switch to the Uncarrier. And the Subway Sandwich Shop. Fresh is what we do.
It's day three of our First Take training camp tour, about to wrap up here from Richmond, Virginia for Redskins camp. But first, our next guest, he's been shutting down the top receivers in the NFL for 12 seasons. We welcome D'Angelo Hall, free safety to the desk. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Man, we
saved the best for last, all right?
We just
had Josh Norman on, and you said this is the best secondary you've been around.
Why?
What makes the secondary so good?
Just the energy. The energy deep. That these guys bring, the competitiveness we compete with in practice, and just the talent, you know, from top to bottom. I mean, we are super talented.
I'm wondering, in all honesty, you know how much respect I got for you. I'm wondering, in all honesty, how fraudulent y'all might be, because every team y'all won against last year, nobody had a winning record.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering how your team feels about itself coming into the season, considering how lucky y'all were to play some mediocre teams.
No, absolutely we were lucky last year. You know, we were a product of a bad division. You know, I've never been one to hide that fact. You know, we were in the playoffs because we were in a terrible division, without a doubt. But, you know, I don't think anybody even picked us to win four games last year. And, you know, we kind of knew that we had to capitalize on the opportunities that were in front of us, and that was playing bad teams. And so this year, you know, having reached the playoffs, I just think it just put a little bit more of a hunger in all these guys' bellies. You know, we feel like if we go out there and compete game in and game out, play in, play out, that we can win games in this league.
Like a lot of top players who play a long time at your positions, they transition from corner to safety. What's your favorite thing about playing safety?
Not having to check receivers. You know,
in this
32
day and age.
Now, I know, absolutely. You can't beat them up like you used to. You know, you can't touch them. I mean, we were just talking about it. It's an offensive league. You know, touchdowns sell tickets. And so, but safety just allows me to be more of a playmaker. You know, I've never said I was a great corner. At one point, I did, but I kind of...
You did, but you were.
As the rules kind of changed,
right.
You know, my philosophy was that, you know, I wasn't a great corner, but I felt like I was a great football player.
Mm-hmm.
And I think playing free safety allows me to be a football player.
You said you can put a fear into quarterbacks.
Absolutely.
Now a safety. What do you mean by that?
if they want to take the chances and throw, I mean, even Kurt, he's a smart guy. He doesn't take too many shots downfield when he sees me back there. And he understands that I'm a guy who loves to get the ball. You know, I got range. You know, I can still run. And so, you know, I just think when a quarterback sees me back there, they're going to think twice about trying to take a shot.
I got
to
ask you, as somebody who's defended wide receivers, who's been in this league for 13 years, DeSean Jackson, Pierre Garçon, Jordan Reed, I think, is a stud. Yeah. How good, and this kid Doxson, I mean, how good is this receiving crew in your mind?
One of the tops in the league. You know, they don't get the credit, but at the end of the day, like you said, you got to back it up. And we know when we put those guys on the field, it's going to pose a challenge for opposing defenses, because you can't double this guy. You can't lean this way. Jordan Reed beats. I mean, Philly tried everything. They put corners on him, safeties, linebackers, doubled him. One play, they had three guys on him, and he still scored. So, I mean, his routes are better than some of our receivers. Mm. You know, me moving to safety, I have to cover him a lot. And I'm telling our coaches, like, bro, he's harder to cover than the receivers are. Because wow. He just has so much shake. He comes from a basketball background.
He's a bad boy.
And, you know, a lot of tight ends, you know, I made the comment he's better than Gronk. Mm-hmm. And Gronk is all world. He's a great football player. But Gronk doesn't scare me, especially being an ex-corner. Because I've been against Randy Moss, T.O., Chad, you know, all the best guys, Hall of Famers. And so, you know, Gronk, I'm not scared he's going to beat me deep. He's going to try to body me, possession, you know, possession receiver type of guy. Where a guy like Jay Reed, when he gives you those shakes, it's like trying to stick a basketball player.
I'm going to end it by saying this. To me, that puts even more pressure on Kirk Cousins. Because you got all the requisite weapons. The job is yours. And yep. You're getting nearly $20 million. I mean, damn. What more you need?
You got to like he's betting on himself.
It's some pressure. But, you know, we think he can rise to the occasion, yeah. Man. And, you know, we trust Kirk.
Contract year.
We got all the confidence in him.
Right. Contract year.
Always, you got to show
always
up.
A good thing, right?
Absolutely.
D'Angelo, thank you so much. And thank you to everyone here for having us in Richmond, Virginia. D'Angelo Hall, good luck to you.
Thank you.
Tomorrow, our road trip continues, Stephen A.
Tampa.
Yes, we're going
James
to Tampa. It might be a little hot. I don't know if you're going to be able to wear the jacket,
hell
though.
No, I ain't wearing it.
It's going to be a little toasty. We'll be at Bucks Camp. Can't wait for that. A lot of special guests joining us. And